G'day, Chris here, and welcome back to Clickspring. With the main body of the tool complete, it's time to take a look at some of the smaller parts of the build. The jaws of the tool are driven towards each other by the cone piece pushing them together. But of course, we need an opposing force to drive them apart as the cone is backed out. And for that, I'm going to use a pair of compression springs that slip into the small gap between the jaws and the pivot block. The position of the springs is such that the spring force is acting just forward of the pivot point to always provide a reaction to the closing force. Music wire is generally specified for springs, but I'll be using some of this tempered blue pivot steel instead, which has very similar properties. For the design of the spring, I'm going with an educated guess of what I think will work. There are some dedicated formulas in the handbook to figure this sort of thing out, but they're definitely not what I would call user-friendly, and I already have a fair idea of what I need. The lathe is still set up for turning that thread from the previous video, and I think a 1.5mm pitch should be about right, so I'm going to keep that change gear setting. Three active coils will be enough to give the required force and still fit within the space that I've allocated to the spring, and I'll terminate the spring with a single inactive coil to seat inside the pivot block. So let's get started. Now there are a few simple tools I need to make for the job. Firstly, I need a guide to hold and then feed in the wire as it's formed into a spiral. So I'm drilling out most of the centre of this 1/8 inch brass rod with a 3mm clearance hole. And then the very end I'm drilling as a close fit for the size of wire that I'm using for the spring, which in this case is 0.7 of a millimetre. The other tool I need is a simple forming arbor around which to form the spring. It's just a narrow cylinder with a cross hole, which I'm going to make from this length of brass rod. I'm using the cross hole drilling jig on the finger play clamping tool, along with two of the guide bushings to form the cross hole. The brass rod was then turned down to the correct diameter for forming the spring, bearing in mind that there will be some spring back once I've finished winding the steel onto the forming arbor. Now a bit of trial and error will give the forming arbor diameter, but again, the handbook has a table to give a good starting point. For the size of the wire that I'm using, the book says a 2.3mm shaft should give me an outside diameter on the spring of just under 4mm. And as it turns out, that's almost exactly what I ended up with when I completed the spring. The wire guide was loaded into a tool holder and then aligned with the cross hole in the forming arbor. The guide was then adjusted to center height, and then a piece of pivot steel stock inserted into position. And finally, with the lead screw engaged and a small amount of steel extending through the cross hole, I manually turned the spindle to form the spring. Now you could certainly do this under power if you wanted to, but I found it easiest to simply turn the spindle by hand. A small spring like this takes hardly an effort at all, and it gave me a lot more control over the process. Once the required number of turns had been formed, I disengaged the lead screw and then put on a single extra coil to act as a flat base for the spring. A jeweler's saw releases the spring from the former, and with the spring cut free, the start piece can be snapped off, and the ends carefully tidied up on the belt sander. Repeat the process, and that's two springs ready to go. Okay, now for the jaw pivots, which are essentially just shouldered fasteners that I formed from E8 medium carbon steel. So with the profile complete, it's time to put in the screwdriver slots. And generally, I don't bother with timing screws, particularly for steel screwing into brass. I did it for these large wheel screws on the clock build, but generally brass is just too soft, and before long the effect is lost. So it's usually just not worth the trouble. But for two hardened screws going into steel, and particularly side by side like this, I think it's essential to have them timed together to avoid jarring the eye. Now it looks best to me if the slots aim slightly off the axis of the tool. So I slotted one screw first, and then once complete, marked out the other to match. Once both slots were formed, the screws were trimmed to length, and then taken through the process of hardening, tempering, and polishing. So that's the small hardware pieces complete. In the next video, I'll make a start on the Vise jaws. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later.